Much, and can I just, for the record, note that we've been in private session and have taken item 4 on the agenda, so we have not wasted our time before welcoming the Cabinet Secretary. Can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary, Derek Mackay, and congratulate him on his new position? There have been so many things happening in the last few days, it seems a long time since you were appointed Cabinet Secretary, but you're very welcome. I'm very pleased you're here on the first occasion in front of this committee. I'm sure you'll be here many times. With you is Alistair Brown, the Acting Director of Financial Strategy, Scott Mackay, the Deputy Director for Financial Programme Management, and Andrew Watson, the Deputy Director for Financial Strategy. I know you want to make an opening statement. After you've made an opening statement, then I'll say a word or two and we'll start the questioning. You might want to tell us why you've been slightly delayed too and how things are this morning.
Okay, thank you very much, convener, for welcoming, a very warm welcome to this opening session of the Finance Committee, and I appreciate your cooperation. The reason for my slight lateness is I was having a phone call with the Chancellor, which I thought would help the conversation and discussion this morning. Indeed, when I accepted the job of Finance Secretary, I was aware that I was inheriting the post at a time of great opportunity, but it was also going to be a period of increasing complexity and uncertainty. I think it's fair to suggest that the level of constitutional and fiscal complexity has increased significantly over the last week. We are, in many ways, in uncharted territory. While many political choices lie ahead of us, I hope that we can all agree that the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament must come together to ensure that we continue to manage the public finances competently and in the interests of the people of Scotland. I come before you today in that spirit and commit to working with all members of this Parliament, particularly those in the Finance Committee, to ensure we achieve those outcomes. I'm also engaging closely with HM Treasury and my counterparts in the other devolved administrations in the interest of our economies and the public finances. The First Minister made a number of statements yesterday in which I associate myself. In particular, I will adopt an approach to the public finances of Scotland that is focused on stability in our economy, reform and improvement in our public services, and continuing to serve this government's vision of a more inclusive and equal society. Convener, the events of the past few days are likely to have a material impact on the public finances, but we cannot let it distract us from the immediate business of government. Even prior to Friday, the powers devolved under Scotland Act 2016 represented a paradigm shift in the way that we run our finances and set our budgets. No longer are we dealing with a budget which focuses almost entirely on expenditure. The coming few years we'll see not only new powers over rates and bands for income tax and new powers over demand-led social security arrangements, but we'll also place a greater emphasis on revenue forecasts, block grant adjustments and budget reconciliations, more so than in any previous budget. The rules have changed and it would be helpful if we could consider and agree today how we might best work together to consider how those new rules are to be reflected in the written agreement and in our processes, both in terms of the 2017-18 budget and for the years beyond. Firstly, as I set out in my letter of last week, if the committee would find it helpful to receive informal briefings from officials on the Scotland Act powers and on the associated fiscal framework agreement, I'd be very glad to arrange that. Beyond that, I think it might be helpful to differentiate between the issues for the long-term future of the budget process and issues for this year in its own right. In the longer term, we need a robust and credible budget process which adequately balances the need for accurate and efficient tax forecasting and collection with the need for effective parliamentary scrutiny. We need to deliver the principles promoted in the original Financial Issues Advisory Group recommendations, whilst not being blind to the fact, for obvious reasons, those recommendations were made in an entirely different context. In this regard, I agree with the relevant recommendation in the previous Finance Committee's legacy paper and suggest that we not only establish a working group involving representatives from the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government, but potentially invite contributions more widely from Civic Scotland to consider what process model would best reflect the extra requirements flowing from the new fiscal powers. Such a group could helpfully include the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who will become an increasingly integral part of the budget process. If the committee is supportive of such an approach, I suggest we invite our respective officials to work together to develop some options for our group for our joint consideration later in the year. In terms of the immediate priority of developing an effective process for developing and scrutinising the draft budget 2017-18, my letter to the committee sets out the government's view on a range of issues associated with the new budget cycle, particularly in the first year of those new powers. My overarching priority is that the people of Scotland must have confidence in our collective ability to use the newly devolved powers efficiently and effectively. In my letter, I set out the view that publishing the draft budget after the Chancellor's autumn statement would represent the most effective way of managing the risks and volatility presented by the relationship between the autumn statement, related OBR forecasts, and the Scottish budget. Such an approach would improve the accuracy of budget forecasts and allocations, reduce the need for revisions to forecasts and allocations ahead of the budget bill, and in my mind, enhance the overall credibility of the budget process. The events of Friday and the days since, and the telephone conversation I've just had, reinforce my view on these questions. While the Chancellor appeared to rule out an immediate emergency budget in a statement on Monday, it is not yet clear what a future UK government's fiscal plans will be, or precisely when they will set them out. Despite the new Scotland Act 2016 powers, almost 60% of the revenues generated in Scotland continue to be determined in Westminster. The block grant adjustment will not be determined until the autumn statement, and it seems clear that the OBR forecast from the March UK budget this year will be subject to significant change. As a consequence, the UK government's plans will continue to have a material impact on the fiscal position in Scotland. It will therefore be important to take appropriate time to consider those plans ahead of our own budget, including whether it should cover the period beyond 2017-18, given the potential timescales around the UK's proposed exit from the European Union between now and the end of the current spending review period in 2019-20. With that in mind, I would invite the committee's views on the budget timetable and specifically my preference that the government should publish the draft budget only once the position for the public finances in Scotland and the UK as a whole is made clear through the Chancellor's autumn statement. I would be happy to discuss these matters and issues and any other matters that the committee might have in mind.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I, before I come to a question, just make one point about what you have said, and it deals with the budgetary model. I want to re-emphasize the point that you have made, that this is a process which is a parliamentary process and is designed as a parliamentary process, and this committee fulfills a fundamental role in that process. And the nature of that relates back to the founding principles of the Parliament. I think it's therefore fundamental that the Parliament leads the tripartite review, and I welcome your comments in that area. Therefore, I want to agree with you that the clerks should discuss with your officials over the summer the shape of that review process to see what it may look like in order that the committee can consider the matter at its business day, the review activity. I also want to thank you for the constructive approach you're taking in working with the committee. There will be many questions that people want to ask you, but I look forward to working with you on these issues as we go forward. The clear first question I really have to ask you is what is your and the Scottish Government's assessment of the potential impact of the Leave vote both on the Scottish budget and on the Scottish economy?
Purely on the financial impact, clearly there's a significant impact on the economy right now in terms of economic turbulence. That will lead into, inevitably, public spending decisions and tax decisions. The Chancellor has said as much, and the conversation I've just had confirmed that, what has been said publicly. Although there's not an emergency budget proposed, there will clearly be a significant shift as the UK government responds to the economic turbulence and the change in circumstances. But for Scotland specifically, clearly there'll be an impact in a range of, if there is to be an exit on funding streams, on wider economy, and on investment decisions. And companies right now will be thinking and some will potentially put on pause some of their investment plans. So that'll have an impact on the wider economy and then in due course government's fiscal decisions. So it's had quite a serious impact already, and I think it'll be prolonged. The Chancellor has said he believes that the UK will be a poorer country as a result, and the predictions that have been made are obviously of some concern, but there will be inevitably an impact on Scotland, and that's why the Scottish Government, in pursuing our ambitions, is trying to sustain Scotland's position and place within the EU, but will be working to deliver stability and then work through all the other potential consequences. And some partners and stakeholders in Scotland are clearly trying to give that continuity and stability as we speak, but there will be a profound impact in this country, and I'm sure members will ask further questions about potentially individual funding streams such as structural funds or other areas where clearly Scotland has played a major role.
We will get into those wider things, but just to focus down on the assumptions that you've been making, I think you've been in post for something like 5 weeks now. Presumably the assumptions you were making about the budget which is about to go into train have changed very significantly in the last 5 days, and that therefore the attitude you will be taking to that will also have changed?
I don't think I could fairly say, or you would believe me if I said it, Convener, that I forecast this outcome. But let's say that it has somewhat vindicated the letter in that there were a number of factors that were very variable in terms of the timing of the budget. It is far too soon to say what the actual impact will be because we do not know. Nobody knows the long-term impact of this decision. But I would reflect on the fact that there were already variables and impacts that we had to consider in setting out the budget timescale for Scotland. And I think the added uncertainty that's now been created by the vote and the fallout has vindicated my position that we needed extra time to ensure that we had an accurate and credible budget process, being able to take into account all the relevant factors. And we are highly dependent, as my letter goes into great detail, on forecasts, on tax revenues, on the position relative to the UK, and on the decisions that then we will then have to make in taking forward the budget process. And of course, I respect this committee. It has to be a fully transparent process, and I want to co-design how we deal with that this year and what's clearly a transition year, but also co-design the solution for the future as well, recognising that the Parliament's powers have moved on, recognised by the previous Finance Committee and the wider issues that now affect us.
Very helpful, thank you. And I think the term co-design is a very useful one. Can I take the Vice Convener first, and then I'll take Adam Tomkins, and then I'll take Patrick Harvey?
Okay. It's interesting to hear the Cabinet Secretary talk about the impact of the EU, given that many would suggest that the impact of withdrawal from the EU would be an order of magnitude smaller than if it was Scotland withdrawn from the UK. Do you take any lessons from the thought process that went through in the independence referendum to the experience that you're going to have withdrawn from the EU?
I'm surprised that Mr. Johnson wants to get into Scottish independence, but if he does, I suppose the difference I could point out is that, at least in Scotland, when we put the choice and the offer to the people, we had a plan. In the white paper, there appears to be no plan, and, you know, UK government is in I think it's fair to say, even Alec Johnson would agree, going through some turbulence at the moment. Not that the Labour Party's escaping that situation either, but in all seriousness, the comparison I'd make, it's good if you put the offer to the people that you have a plan. And what we're dealing with now is the immediate fallout of that decision. We're striving to secure Scotland's position and working in the best interests of our people by delivering strong, competent government, pursuing Scotland's interests, and for me, looking ahead to the challenges it will face. And this committee will have a huge role and shaping our process as we adapt to the circumstances.
We already had problems with timescale. We're aware of that. They're discussed in the letter that we have in front of us. So the changes that have happened in the last few days, what does that do to the pressures both for yourself and for Parliament, in terms of fitting this process within a timescale?
Well, I thank Mr. Johnson for those comments and the recognition that we already had important issues to wrestle with. There was already transition and change and uncertainty in how we go forward, and that was, you know, pre-EU referendum vote in terms of the forecast that we would rely on and expecting further change. For example, we were already expecting somehow the Chancellor to allocate a further £3.5 billion worth of cuts to his own budget, and we have to deal with that. So that and all the other variables that I've outlined in the letter. In terms of timescales, what this result has done is added uncertainty to the shape of the UK government. The Chancellor doesn't know whether he will be the Chancellor, who his successor may be, but he does know that there will be significant financial adjustments as a result of the decision, and it follows that therefore there have been impact on budgets and the wider economy to which we will all have to respond. The Chancellor was of the view, I mean, anything can happen between now and then, but the autumn statement is likely to have such a adaptation, and therefore it's wise to wait for that position to understand Scotland's budgetary position, not just because our spending power will change, but all the forecasts will change, and that information that we rely upon is more significant than ever. So in terms of our immediate spending pressures, it's too soon to say, but we'll know that the timescale has significantly changed, and there is now more weight upon the Chancellor's autumn statement. And I suspect that probably will not be the end of the matter, because the long-term consequences of this decision remain to be seen.
Last year's process was truncated. We're now in what the Cabinet Secretary himself described as a transitional year. And it seems that the process in this unique and difficult year will have to be truncated again. Are we at a stage where there is serious concern that must be raised about whether we can adequately analyse the budget in the timescale that we have, and whether there is a danger that the government may be allowed to progress matters without proper scrutiny from Parliament?
No, I actually think if you look at potential scenarios of timescales, I think it's still perfectly possible to have adequate scrutiny of the government's budget, but surely all members of the committee would appreciate you would rather have an accurate budget than an inaccurate budget that's subject to so much change that I would just respond to every question by saying, oh, that's likely to change. And I think you must have an accurate and credible proposed draft budget. And I won't spend my contribution this morning saying the added uncertainty to the economy, the likelihood of change, and all of that is down to the Conservatives' government's choices. But the reality is some of the, or all of the budget timing issues has come from when the UK government has chosen to do its spending reviews, when it's chosen to determine its budgets, because such a large part of our budget, and this will continue to be the case, comes from the block grant and decisions of the UK government. So we are still in large measure in their hands in terms of large financial decisions that we should take, and the room for manoeuvre we have in other taxes because of the fiscal agreement, financial agreement, still relies on us to make sound decisions flowing from what the UK government proposes to do. I accept the point we must have clear Finance Committee and parliamentary scrutiny of our proposed draft budget, but it has to be a credible, accurate proposed budget so you know what you're studying is reasonable and is likely, you know, subject to all the political negotiation that will be required with the position of the government and the parliament, given proper time. And I'll give you a pledge, you know, maximum involvement in how we design this, you know, process going forward. Of course, what we haven't solved, and it'll be for this joint working group, if it's agreed, to consider, is another issue, not just around the reliability of forecasts or the outcome of UK spending decisions, but also the fair ability of the government to make tax decisions that don't necessarily encourage bad behaviour because we want to be able to continue to be able to raise our taxes. So there's also thinking around how the Parliament's scrutiny process adapts to the fact that we're no longer just a spending Parliament, but a tax-raising Parliament as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for your statement. I don't want to talk about Scottish independence. It won't surprise you to learn. I want to talk about effective parliamentary scrutiny. And you used the word just now that you want parliamentary scrutiny to be adequate. Well, with respect, I want it to be better than that. I want it to be a lot better than that. I want it to be as effective and as robust as it can possibly be. And that isn't just in the government's interest, that's in Scotland's national interest. And it is, of course, for the Parliament to decide what effective parliamentary scrutiny is, not for the government to decide that, as I'm sure you would agree. So I just wonder what you can say now to reassure me as a new parliamentarian that the process that you are proposing, which is that, as I understand it, a draft budget won't be given to this committee until after the autumn statement, can result in the most effective and robust parliamentary scrutiny possible. The autumn statement is, of course, misnamed. The autumn statement is these days often given in the winter, only a fortnight or so before Christmas. So are you proposing that a draft budget would be given to this committee before Christmas or only in the new year? And if you are proposing that the start of the parliamentary process with regard to budget scrutiny is delayed, are you also proposing that the end of that process can be delayed so that we have more time in the spring? Or is there a kind of, does the clock still stop, as it were, at the same point in the calendar?
Mr. Tompkins raises a number of excellent questions. Let me just take a binary position in terms of what's adequate. So the opposite of adequate is inadequate, and I don't want an inadequate budget process. So we actually share a view on the standard of scrutiny that should be undertaken for the budget process. I'm just striving to ensure that this committee gets sight of an accurate, credible budget rather than rushing anything. Considering the UK government's position right now, and the UK government can't even say, and I understand the reasons for this, when the autumn statement will be, it is difficult, therefore, for me to give you my proposed timescale. But I can give you the pledge, again, that as soon as we reasonably can publish our draft budget, you know, if this is what's agreed by the committee, and you're right, this is a parliamentary agreement, it's a protocol that as soon as we reasonably can publish a draft budget after the Chancellor's autumn statement, we would do that. I'm not trying to delay publication of budget for any other reason, and I want it to be credible, and I want it to be based on spending decisions that have a material impact on those decisions by way of tax and revenue and spending as well. So the timing is in part in the UK government's hands, and I expressed that view to the Chancellor this morning, that it is an uncomfortable place to be, to have to wait for this, but it is more significant than ever. The timescales that you suggest, they might be right, but I don't know, because the UK government doesn't know when the statement that they will give will be. They can't say, to be fair, even who the Chancellor will be, whether it will be George Osborne or whether he will have a successor. But they will want to make their decisions, and ours should follow from that. In terms of, you know, the autumn statement in the winter, apparently civil servants can redefine many things, including our seasons, and it could well be in the winter, but the sooner the better, frankly, so that we can all go on with greater certainty with what we want to do. And you know, there may be further budget variations after that. I'm not proposing to wait for further events. I'm saying that's the most significant event. And as time goes on, the previous budget process, I mean, this is why the Parliament has to change. The current process, the current agreement, actually doesn't fit with the new timescales for forecasts, whether it be the OBR or the Fiscal Commission or anything else. It just doesn't fit with what we would seriously rely upon to design a credible budget. And I say this year, that's why we're very much in transition this year, and I want to co-design with this committee what will work best for the future, and that should look at timescales at the other end. To finish my answer here is, I think we'll have to look through the overall timescale, how the committee conducts its business, how intensively the committee sits and calls witnesses and plans out its work, engages with other committee. It is very much a matter for the committee. We'll be supportive within that, but there are other drivers at the other end of the process as well, such as intimation of the Scottish rate of income tax or other things we will have to do to fit with the rest of the formulaic approach and how this budget is set by the Scottish Parliament.
That was partly reassuring, but not quite as reassuring as I would ideally have wanted it to be. And I very much welcome your pledge to co-design the process with the committee. Perhaps we can just get a little bit more specific, though, about what you have in mind, albeit that this can't possibly commit you, but just to give us an indication of what you have in mind. How long do you think it would be after the autumn statement that you'll be able to bring a draft budget to the committee? Are we talking about a week or two, or are we talking about 6 weeks or 7 weeks? Are we talking about something that could realistically start before the Christmas recess or can't realistically start until after the Christmas recess? And you didn't address my point about whether, if we're not going to start until later, whether we still have to finish at the same time. Is there any way in which we can extend this process, you know, later into the spring or summer?
I suppose we will have to look at what has to be done before that's partly why we have to redesign how we do our business, because there are other parts of the parliamentary process that we need to undertake, certainty at the other end for our stakeholders as well, and the process that the Parliament has to go through for the staged approach for the budget as well. So I think all that will have to be considered. Just the unknown determinant here is when the UK autumn statement will be. What I'm pledging to do is to turn that around into a Scottish budget as quickly as I can. Don't think for 1 minute that we won't be doing anything until the Chancellor's autumn statement. We will plan and undertake to deliver the budget, but it'll be what we don't know is the scale of adjustment. So if I can look at the timetable at the other end in partnership with you, because it's, you know, the committee will help determine this, then I'll happily do that to see can we extend it at the other side. In terms of exact timings, my understanding from significant shift to publication of a budget in the past has been around 3 weeks. But we are in unprecedented times. But I would try, as best I could, for all the reasons you understand, to get a published draft budget out in a matter of weeks after the Chancellor's autumn statement. What I don't know is the scale of change that any Chancellor will propose, but I'll of course work very hard to get that budget produced as quickly as possible thereafter, if committee agrees with that approach. And I think in these times we have to work together on a cross-party basis, and that's what I'm proposing. Equally, we have a huge political difference with the UK government, but we're also trying to deliver stability and continuity and sound government at the same time, in terms of financial matters in the Scottish budget. So I'm trying to be as open-minded as I possibly can be, Mr. Tompkins, whilst recognising that some of the other determinants in this process are already set, and that includes when we have to execute other functions as per the budget process.
There are people...
Okay, I'm so sorry.
Can I come back to you? We want to do it. Patrick.
Convener, good morning. You used the word unprecedented a moment ago, and a great deal about this situation feels unprecedented, feels unique. I would remind you that your party formed a minority government in 2007, and not very long after, okay, not a matter of weeks, but not very long after, faced the beginning of a financial crisis, which clearly was going to have a profound impact for years to come. Part of what your predecessor did in his approach to that was not merely to rely on budget scrutiny, but to have plenty of upfront discussion across the political spectrum about the broad brushstrokes, about principles, for example, about whether, you know, everyone would be agreed on trying to retain maximum employment, even if it meant a pay freeze, you know, that being preferable to laying off large numbers of people in the public sector. Those broad brushstrokes were agreed in advance of the development of the budget, not as an alternative to budget scrutiny when the budget was there. I'm just wondering whether that's going to be the approach that you'll take as well in the current situation, and also whether either your own government or, to the best of your knowledge, the UK government have made any assumptions about the long-term impacts of the current situation, for example, on the value of the pound. Are you working on an assumption that that might be a permanent correction, or do you have other scenarios that you're developing and trying to explore what the implications will be?
Well, on the first issue, on a matter of principle, the government has been elected on a manifesto that I think the First Minister's been clear on. We aim to achieve in full. So that's what we're working towards, the delivery of our manifesto. And there's a not insignificant matter of, irrespective of the timing of the budget and the other impacts on the budget, I've also got to build a majority for the Scottish budget as well. And I expect those discussions to happen in advance of just publishing what the government proposes to do. So there will be ongoing engagement. In terms of longer-term economic impact, I think it's fair to say that the result and the impact has come as a shock, and therefore UK government and commentators and economists are all looking at it, and I'm very mindful now, more so than ever, that forecasters and economists will come up with models, but they are only forecasts. There is an impact. There will be a short, medium and a long-term impact. This much we know. If I boil it down to what the Chancellor has said, he has said that the UK will be poorer, and that's his position. He said other things, such as there would be an emergency budget. He said publicly that there may be increased taxes and reduced public spending as well. From memory, I think Alistair Darling, when they shared the platform, took a similar view. So there is consensus that there will be a short, medium and long-term impact on the economy, but everyone is working to stabilise the impact. And within Scotland, we'll look at as we do every day, every week, the impact on Scotland and what we can do to assist. Of course, we are pursuing the agenda of continuing Scotland's place in the EU, and I can say that there have been a number of inquiries from people, political and business, as to how they think they could fit within that context in Scotland. So, you know, there's huge financial challenge, but there's also opportunity as well in terms of sustainable economic growth and then impact on fiscal policy for the UK and the Scottish government. Of course, we're looking at scenarios, and there are also immediate inquiries that we will be undertaking to give people reassurance around some of the funding streams that are EU-related. Does that assist?
I mean, I think there are clearly several different kinds of impact. One will be about EU funding streams, and clearly that's not going to be taken away altogether, but there'll be an impact before the Brexit negotiations are complete, no doubt. Secondly, on the taxation system in Scotland, which is developing, and what the impact of the current financial crisis will be on the revenues that come from devolved taxes. And thirdly, on the continuing financial relationship with the UK, where sadly there is no detriment principle in relation to massive gambles that the UK government chooses to take with the economy. It's clearly too early to disaggregate all three of these and to start pinning them down. But they're all going to be based on a range of different scenarios. And I'm wondering who's most responsible, your government or the UK government, for making the assumptions that will inform the decisions that we make?
A great number of the assumptions that we would be making would be based on what the UK government does. So we will be undertaking our own work, and we will have a different agenda. UK government will make their assumptions. I'll be able to say more about just some of the immediate decisions that the Scottish government's taken in light of this. Mr. Harvey referenced devolved taxes, and I'll be able to say a wee bit more about that in the outturn statement this afternoon, because it does have a material consideration in that. So there are some immediate decisions that I'll say more about in relation to the outturn statement, because they absolutely relate to devolved taxes on what's happened in the last financial year and what we should do going forward.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, I've got three questions. Firstly, on the question of the timing of the budget and the implications for budget scrutiny. In the last Parliament, I convened the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee, and we had, well, I think the members in that committee would agree, was an unsatisfactory situation where, which was met by all the subject committees, where we were doing budget scrutiny in advance of the budget being published. We are now facing a scenario which I entirely understand is not of your making, Cabinet Secretary, and we all understand the reasons why it's come around. But we're facing a scenario where the subject committees might have perhaps a matter of weeks, if that, in which to scrutinise the budget and report to this committee as they're required to do. And in terms of making calls for evidence and consulting with stakeholders, maybe a matter of days, given that it might fall over the Christmas recess. Have you thought at all about how that process might be enhanced or made credible, given the very, very short time likely to be available for subject committees to scrutinise the budget?
I think that if we deliver some innovation here, we can think differently as to how we approach scrutiny. There are other things that the committee could focus their attention on, and it actually relates to Mr. Harvey's view on pre-budget engagement as well. You know, there is room potentially to help guide public policy and guide government on priorities as well. And why should it just be the case that government publishes our budget and then you scrutinise it? Is there not a role to help guide government even before we have published a draft budget? So I think we could be creative and innovative around engaging in the process. And in these transitionary times, I think we can do things differently on how other subject committees engage, how proactive they are, how intensively they look at the budget, and also how they program their work. If we have more clarity in what timescales could look like, then the budget process could have absolute priority for those committees at that point. There may be opportunity for committees that might not be too popular, but to sit more often during that period or to look at the process. And I'm not saying that, and I used to be a member of the Finance Committee, albeit briefly when I was first a member of Parliament. It's not always the case that the budget's produced and there was intensive scrutiny. Sometimes there was a period of there wasn't active scrutiny. So I think there's a way we can do things differently. I'm trying not to curtail the length of time. It's just inevitable following from the issues that have arisen. So I'm saying we should cooperate to innovate to ensure that there's adequate scrutiny, and subject committees, I think, could plan out their scrutiny ahead, and we'll look at how much time they can be given. Bearing in mind Mr. Tompkins' point around, can we look at any further extension at the other end of the process?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. I think that's quite a helpful response, Convener, and it's something we can explore further with the Cabinet Secretary and his officials. My second point relates to the comments you were making earlier, and yourself, Camina, were making earlier about economic impact of the Brexit vote. Do you think there's a danger of us talking ourselves into recession here? Because there has been so much conversation about uncertainty. We sometimes forget, first of all, we are still in the EU for the time being. There is as yet no timetable to leave. The fundamentals of the economy are still sound. And in fact, perhaps what we need is a bit more positivity and reassurance about some of these issues rather than a lot of doom and gloom from politicians, which might just lead to a situation where we exacerbate an already troublesome situation.
Oh, to be fair to me, Convener, I didn't mention the word recession. It was Mr. Fraser that mentioned the word recession and said no one should mention recession. but I'm all for, but I have a happy, positive disposition in life, and I think I've been rather generous right now to the UK government as well. Mr. Fraser also said this isn't a mess of the Scottish Government's making. No, it certainly is not. I wouldn't just easily throw back it's a Conservative mess, but this is the point where we have to work together, because nobody wants impact negatively on our people or our economy, or that includes for the whole of the UK, not just Scotland, in light of how Scotland would. So I agree, actually, that we should get on with the job, deal with the situation, deliver stability as best we can, be pragmatic about the challenges that we face. Of course, we have different political aspirations. We have a different view on the outcome of the referendum, but I think there was a degree of consensus even yesterday in the chamber about pursuing Scotland's interests. And so there's a degree to which we should work together and be positive in delivering stability and, from my point of view, from the Scottish Government, take the opportunity that is before us in terms of a very positive European view of the people of Scotland and opportunity that exists. So I won't be talking Scotland down. I will be using my role to try and enhance our position, protect our position, and deliver as much protection as we can for our people in light of circumstances. And my advice to Mr. Fraser is, if you want to join us in talking up Scotland, well, I'm certainly be first to welcome that. And that includes in the Parliament plenary session this afternoon.
Well, I hope, Cabinet Secretary, you won't be talking anybody down rather than just Scotland, but we'll see. Okay, my final question is slightly slightly distinct matter, and that is you announced, or I think your predecessor announced last year, there was to be a review of business rates. Are you able to tell us when a remit for that business rates review is likely to be published, and how extensive is that likely to be? So will it just be tweaking some of the process issues, such as the periods for rate revaluations, or will it be much more fundamental, looking at whether the current system should be replaced with something more radical than is currently existing?
Well, Mr. Fraser, I'm not sure how much time we have at this committee, convener, but I could go into more detail. I think it's probably more helpful if I write to the committee on the current position in relation to the review of business rates, because I could say more on I'm increasingly populating the membership of the review. I've met with the chair. I can say more about the remit and the direction of travel. I'm happy to write to the committee to more fully update on the review and the direction that I've given, and then the review can go on and explore. So the timescale, I think, was summer next year for reporting back. So I think business rates is certainly an area that the committee would be very interested in. I would be happy to give you more detail in writing about the work that's been undertaken. That includes membership, as I say, which have progressed since probably last you considered it.
Yes.
Thank you. Well, we'll look forward to getting that from you. I think I counted your three questions and they're all complete. So, Kate Forbes.
Thank you very much. Just bearing in mind the uncertainty that we've already touched on, both economically and politically, and moving on to a slightly different subject, what are your thoughts at the moment on having enough long-term confidence to do a three-year spending review?
I think that, convener, I would want to say, as it stands right now, with the degree of uncertainty that exists, with the volatility that exists, I think it would be unwise to publish a three-year spending review at this time. So we're proposing a one-year budget and not delivering a three-year spending review at this time. As it happens, the UK government had published a three-year spending review, but it's clear that they may revisit that as they approach the issues that they face. So I believe, convener, it's fair to say, and I think I'm being perfectly transparent when I say it, that it would be unwise to publish a three-year spending review. So I'm looking at a one-year budget and not the publication of a three-year spending review in light of all the circumstances that we face. If we had greater certainty around the three-year spending review, then we could proceed with that, but I don't think that would be the right thing to do at this time. That said, clearly the Scottish Government won't just take a short-term view on the budget, but will consider the long-term matters. It's also the case that, and this is just a point of accuracy and technical correctness, it's not me, I don't want to lead you down this road, but publication of a spending review doesn't necessarily have to wait to the budget process. It could, in theory, be delivered at any point, and you could have the opportunity to consider a separate scrutiny approach of that. If I was to publish a spending review at any other point other than the budget process, but I want to be clear with the committee, that is my thinking at this time, that a three-year spending review publication of would be unwise at this time, therefore I'm working to a one-year budget, and I'm sure everyone would agree that's a reasonable thing to do in the circumstances.
That's very helpful. I think we just have to be absolutely clear that that is now the proposal, because I think that is a step beyond where we were an hour ago or so. Your proposals will not include this year a three-year spending review.
That is correct, Convener, and I hope that that assists you with realising that I'm not asking
absolutely.
You to scrutinise a three-year spending review, because I won't be publishing one. I'm proposing a one-year budget.
That is what we will focus on when we come to the issue of the budget time table, which is helpful. Thank you. Kate, do you want to?
That was
you. Fine, thank you. Willie Coffey.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. This is certainly one holy mess, I think, that the Conservative government has got us into, and I think you're doing pretty well in trying to outline to the committee plans to take forward, you know, our plans to reform, you know, and to scrutinise Scottish Government budget spending and proposals. But in your discussion with the Chancellor after his reappearance this morning, did he give you any kind of indication about, in his autumn statement, whether there will be any kind of plans or provisions to make adjustments because of the situation with the EU? Because the public perception of this during the debate was that suddenly all of this funding that came from the EU would be maintained and spending from the UK. Now, it's probably too early to do that, but has he given you any kind of indication at all so that the British public can be absolutely clear what the UK position is going to be with respect to budgets and whether they can expect things like an extra £350 million a week for the National Health Service? Has that been nailed in the head by the Chancellor, for example, or is it still doing the rounds?
First of all, Mr. Coffey, I don't think even the Chancellor could say it'll be his statement in the autumn. He made the point to me it could be him or his successor. So he can only speak for his perspective at the moment and his intelligence from within the UK government. But he has said publicly that he predicts, and he's, this wouldn't be a surprise considering what he said during the European referendum, that he does expect taxes to go up and spending to go down. And he also prefaced that with saying he thought that the UK would be poorer as a result of the vote. And obviously trying to give stability and continuity to the UK as well, and calm the markets, and has a range of contingency plans in place with the Bank of England, should that be required. So I suppose there was an attempt for reassurance within that, but I think he's been quite clear, and I say other people have concurred about the impact on tax and spend. So yes, he does expect it to have an impact. Of course, what the Chancellor said during the referendum and after, maybe some of that will be subject to change, but Mr. Coffey referenced on the £350 million to the NHS and other positions as well. I could add on immigration. Much of what was said before the vote, I think, will transpire to be totally inaccurate. And I'll have to stick within parliamentary parameters of language, but I think many of the things that people were told during the referendum will turn out not to be true. But unfortunately, an economic impact has turned out to be true. The scale of financial adjustment that we will have to wrestle with, we do not know, and the Chancellor does not know. But I did raise the subject, is it reasonable to assume that there will be a significant shift in the autumn statement? And of course, that's what I'm saying to this committee is an important material consideration in our thinking about our timetable process. And, you know, is that a reasonable position to take, that there will be an impact in the autumn statement, and he concurred that yes, there would be. It might not be a matter for that Chancellor, but there will be a shift in public finances and tax policies as a consequence of the vote. So I think the approach that I'm outlining in that light is a reasonable one. Does that answer your question, Mr. Coffey?
Yep. It's interesting, Cabinet Secretary and Convener, that we can't find anybody who admits to actually making that claim now that there would be all of this funding and extra money made available to the NHS, but that, I suppose that's the nature of the debate during the referendum. But could I ask you a second question just about how we, or whether you plan to engage with the devolved administrations or in their respective impacts, perhaps on Wales and Northern Ireland, and also actually the Republic of Ireland, who will be considerably affected in their view. I think that's quite clear. Are you reaching out to those administrations? I know you're extremely busy doing what you have to do, but what kind of association are you planning to have with those?
The First Minister and Fiona Hislop, Cabinet Secretary, and other ministers are clearly engaging with counterparts. Before the referendum had taken office and after, I have engaged with other my equivalents of finance ministers and devolved administrations, including the Chief Secretary to the Treasury and the Chancellor. In terms of the devolved administrations, we have engaged and I'm planning to meet them later in July. That should include the Northern Ireland Finance Minister and the Welsh Finance Minister. And also had the pleasure of meeting the Irish equivalent of Public Expenditure Minister as well. So I have been engaging with devolved administrations and the Irish Finance Minister as well. And I look forward to ongoing constructive engagement where we have shared interests. And as I say, there's a further meeting scheduled in Wales between the three devolved administration finance ministers later in July. Of course, they will want to protect their position, and I'll certainly pursue Scotland's position and what's in our best interest. But yes, there's a great deal of frustration as to what has happened. And I was engaging with devolved administrations before the vote because I wanted a good, strong relationship in finance terms between the devolved administrations.
Timetable or the timetable you're suggesting for us, is that broadly shared by the devolved administrations too? Because presumably they're facing the same situation that we are, frankly. They're basically looking at the same kind of timetable for their own scrutiny processes there, do you think?
Sometimes we wrestle with similar issues or similar positions in terms of how we engage with the UK government. We are completely different devolved administrations with different tax and spend mechanisms, budget processes, parliamentary scrutiny, and everything else. So although we have many issues in common, there isn't a similarity really in approach. So I haven't discussed with them their timetabling issues, but we certainly agree on a number of issues of principle.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. James.
Thanks a lot, Convener. Two questions from me. You noted in your letter, Cabinet Secretary, the £3.5 billion of public spending cuts coming down the line, and obviously you've correctly assessed that there's going to be a material impact of the Leave vote. You also said that this is a different budget and it's not a spending budget. We've also got to consider the implications of tax. I just wondered what your policy intent was in terms of the tax raising powers. Do you intend to adopt a tax neutral approach or to raise taxes or reduce them?
As it stands, Convener, we outlined in our manifesto what our tax position would be, and that's our current proposition. Now, like with any government or any administration, we'll have to look at all the budget issues, the spending pressures, the impact of the Chancellor's autumn statement. But as it stands, the manifesto that we were elected upon is the one that we are aiming to deliver, and that had a range of proposals around income tax and other measures.
Clear, is it tax neutral? Is it going to put taxes up or reduce taxes?
Well, it's as it was stated in the manifesto, and I think members would benefit from the full briefings, I suppose, that I have had in terms of the financial agreement between the the Scottish Government and UK Government vis-a-vis the fiscal framework. So there's a clear understanding of what the impact of tax decisions would be between Scotland and the UK Government.
Sorry,
so, okay, we will, through our spending power, have generated more income through our tax position.
Okay, so that would be the position, that your policy intent. I accept that you've got to assess the impact of recent changes, but at this minute in time, your policy intent is to raise more money from taxes.
As it stands, the position that we've outlined in the manifesto, and I suppose this is a prelude now to the budget, but as it stands, we had a policy on income tax and a policy on council tax and other positions, which through those decisions and what UK government said they were intending to do at that time would increase our spending power for more resources for public services. To now say in isolation, I know this is now incredibly complex because of the way the fiscal framework operates, that it's no longer just the case that the Scottish Government raises its taxes and therefore we have more income, and it's as simple as that. Everything is now relative to what the UK Government does, the impact in the block grant adjustment, and therefore it's more complex. So I'm not trying to be unhelpful, but putting words into my mouth is not necessarily helpful in the context of accuracy. Our tax proposals will increase the spending power of the UK government as it stood because of the position that we've outlined and what UK government said they were going to do at the time, around particularly income tax thresholds, and then, of course, separate to that, council tax.
The spending power of the Scottish government.
Yes. Well, of course, it's the spending power of the Scottish government. Yes. Yes. For the avoidance of doubt, I'm not trying to spend anyone else's money.
Okay, I'm clear on where you stand. Second point, just going back to the discussion or the point that Murdo Fraser raised about budget scrutiny and how the curtailed timetable would compromise the ability of this committee and subject committee to scrutinise the budget. Obviously, you'll be, you know, continually running and updating your forecasting models. Is there information from that that you would be able to make available to your proposed working group, this committee and subject committees to help inform us ahead of the publication of your spending plans?
I don't necessarily think that that would be particularly helpful, putting in the public domain forecasts that will have so many variables. It almost, you know, I think that would create further uncertainty, and our modelling, we will obviously have to work to a programme, but let me consider that further, what information we could share with the committee. But what I wouldn't want to do is, you know, if I'm not publishing a draft budget, why would I publish a whole host of scenarios that would give a degree of credibility to scenarios that might not turn out to be accurate? So let me consider what I could share with the committee in real time, especially in light of, you know, trying to be helpful and transparent, but not in a way that sets hairs running.
Sure, I accept that. I wouldn't be proposing that you publish any information that fuels uncertainty, but anything that would help inform members and people involved in the budget process, I think, would be helpful.
I think that's a very important point. Could I just say, I think Murdo Fraser and James Kelly, the question, and Adam Tompkins did earlier, in terms of the level of information that would be made available both to the committee and to the spending committees in the absence of a draft budget. I mean, we haven't talked about that detail and that timescale, but I think that is an important point, and I think it will recur in the discussions of the committee, so I just underline that point. Ash Denham.
Thank you. Clearly, recent events are having, you know, immediate and let's just call them wide-ranging effects on the Scottish economy. Is the Scottish Government discussing, you know, options to stimulate investment, and is there any money that could be found to allocate to that?
I'm sure that, well, first of all, I would want to say that Cabinet Secretaries across government are engaging with key stakeholders, and that's right across sectors to understand impact, to take on board sensitivities, intelligence as well, not just in the business community, but much wider than that. Also, the First Minister's outlined the position on the creation of an expert panel in relation to the EU. But of course, beyond that, from ministerial meetings hours after the result, then into an emergency Scottish Cabinet on the Saturday. We have been tasked with engaging with stakeholders to assess the position, to support, to provide continuity, to convey the government's message, to hear from all sectors, and equally to try and seize any opportunities that might exist. And there have been inquiries, for example, from people interested in operating from Scotland in the event that, you know, Scotland could continue its place in the EU, but the rest of the UK takes a different decision. In terms of budget allocations to do that work, cabinet secretaries and departments would be expected to get on with it within existing resources, because our budget for this financial year is set, but civil servants and government will adapt to circumstances, and clearly we will all adapt to the opportunities that arise. And I'd consider any requests for additional resources or variations, but I would expect departments to find it within existing resources to be able to go on with that kind of work that Ash Denham has suggested.
Thank you. Neil Bibby.
Thanks, Kevin. I just wanted to ask you about the impact of a delayed budget on the wider public sector. Obviously, there's been discussion about timescales and looking at the end of the process. But of course, you'll know as a former leader of a council that councils legally need to set their budget, and I think around the 10th of March. And last year, because of a delayed budget, there was a number of alterations and corrections that were being made to local authority budgets right up until just a week beforehand. So obviously, there'll be concern there. I know there's also was concern amongst colleges last year who get their budget through the Scottish Funding Council. I'm equally aware that health boards historically set their budgets around the June period, but of course their contribution to the health and social care budgets aren't finalised until they set their own budget. So I'm interested to know what assurances you can give or what action you can take to allow public sector organisations, local authorities, proper time to effectively plan for their financial year ahead, and what information that, you know, outline or otherwise that you can do to allow them to do their job properly.
Well, Mr. Bibby helpfully answered part of his own point in that you were able to say timing's important, but then of course you said that alterations and corrections feature as well. And I can say if we rushed ahead with the budget, knowing everything we know now and assessing what we don't know, but knowing everything we know now, if we were to set too premature a budget, there would be an immense amount of corrections and adjustments that would have a material impact in the final outcome. So I think it's my judgment that getting an accurate, credible budget is the right thing to do and the most prudent and effective thing to do. But of course, other delivery partners and stakeholders will want certainty from figures, and they'll want a direction of travel. And in a perfect world, I would like to be delivering a three-year spending review as well to give that certainty, not just around the direction of travel, but also I think there are strong messages around public service reform and transformation that we'll have to return to as well. So I think it's about stability and clarity, a credible budget, and not one that has to be corrected with all the necessary adjustments, because we went too soon and there was a seismic shift in potential financial issues. So I hear the point, I accept the point, particularly for local authorities and other organisations that depend upon our spending decisions around that. So if I can give any early clarity, then I'll try and do that. And of course, I want to work in partnership with local authorities and others, but I know that they would appreciate accuracy as well. And I suppose that helps make the point that Adam Tompkins raised earlier around the process at the other end. I am mindful of local authorities who I have to debate and set and plan for their budgets, and other organisations that will want good time, so to do, before the start of the new financial year. So the burden we have collectively is to try and make the timescales work for absolutely everyone, but also deliver good, competent government and sound financial decision making in light of all of that. And in terms of the wider public sector, We're all evaluating the position and the situation at the moment. We'll have to deal with the level of uncertainty, but we will be very clear with our organisations and with partners and stakeholders what we can do. And I say again that just because there'll be a one-year budget doesn't mean that we shouldn't take a long-term approach and that transformation that has to happen in any event.
Thank you very much. I'm going to ask Ivan McKee now, and then we'll move to wind up. We're making good time.
Cabinet Secretary, I've got there's two areas I wanted to touch on, two questions, one around spend and one around tax. And just going on to the spend one first, you know, obviously the situation we're in, we're in a period of uncertainty, and there certainly more likely than not will be pressure on the public sector spend. And there was a couple of issues in the legacy paper that I think they're related. I just want to get your view and comments on. One was round about outcomes-based spending in terms of big spend departments focusing or understanding better the relationship between the money they were spending and the outcomes they were delivering for that. And the second one, which I think is related, was around about preventive spending or preventive investment, understanding how we spend money up front to deliver the lower cost through reducing the symptoms or the effects of lack of investment up front, round about what's been talked about in the Christie Commission. So I just wanted to, and as a further point to that, clearly there was a letter sent to your predecessor back in March of this year round about the preventive issues, a number of points were raised. So it was really just to understand if that was something that was on your agenda and if we were going to see any response back to that letter.
In terms of, those are helpful questions, and in terms of the outcomes-based approach, so the government has put a great deal of weight on the national performance framework, the outcomes that we would like to achieve, and calibrating government towards those priorities and the outcomes. So yes, we're looking very closely at that work and, you know, how we report it as well through Scotland Performs and have people have that in mind. So we'll continue to look at that focus. And also when I'm looking at the budget ahead, and you'll want to scrutinise this, how are departments aligning their funding to the outcomes that we want to achieve? And incidentally, I think it was a Labour member in the chamber that asked the question. I wasn't there to be able to answer it, but there was a round table approach focusing on what the outcomes for the country should be. It was the round table and looking at some of this. So I want to continue a, you know, cross-party approach and help establish what the national outcomes should continue to be, but have a clear focus on that and aligning resources to priorities rather than just, you know, what does your department want to do, but what are we trying to achieve? So there's a great deal of work in that, especially when going through a budget exercise. That's the opportunity to help focus the mind. So yes, that work will continue, as will our approach on prevention. Again, I was on the Finance Committee when we looked at prevention. There's a great deal of political buy-in and consensus around making the right spending decisions to have the right preventative approach. And so we want to continue with that. And I could list a number of manifesto commitments or policies that we've adopted that fit in with that thinking very, very nicely. But I think there's more work to be done on prevention. I'm not aware of any outstanding correspondence, but if there is on this its subject, I'm happy to come back in writing on what the member has raised.
The point was on taxation and specifically on the issue of additional rate tax. And I know that this clearly was a discussion during the election campaign. And I know that some work was done around about the behavioural impacts of that tax. And clearly it's a very complicated area because of the interplay between tax, dividend, capital gains, the ability of people to move tax base, etc. at that level. But there's a lot of layers within that, and there's no one answer to all of the people within that bracket. They've all got completely different circumstances potentially. So I don't know if there was any thoughts as to do some more detailed work to further understand the potential behavioural impacts of different segments within what may be called that additional tax bracket?
Again, a very interesting question. A number of members of this committee will take a completely different approach on what we should do with that particular tax lever, but our manifesto position was clear, but we want to understand tax behaviours and what certainty we could have from income generation if a particular tax proposition was taken forward. Therefore, we've asked that the Council of, or we will ask the Council of Economic Advisers to consider this matter, and then we'll, I'm happy to return to the committee with whatever advice we ultimately receive on what a proposition may happen to achieve by way of tax behaviours. Members will recall that we said through the course of the Scottish Parliament election that it was pointless to raise a tax if it didn't generate the income. It would have been counterproductive. I think we're happy to explore the thinking around that and return to committee with whatever intelligence we have.
Yeah. Thank you.
That would be useful to us, I think. You wanted to...
Very briefly, on the issue of tax behaviour, you say in your letter to the convener of the 23rd of June that protecting future revenues, which may be under some circumstances eroded by tax avoiding behaviours. I wondered what you envisaged or what powers you had or what actions you envisage to attempt to influence tax avoiding behaviour.
Of course, we would look at that and you know, bottom line is pay your taxes, and we would work very hard to be proactive in pursuing people to pay what they're due to pay. And I think the culture and the devolved taxes that we have seems to be quite effective. I think Revenue Scotland's doing a very good job in pursuing and receiving the income that's due from those devolved taxes that we currently have as a consequence of a previous Scotland Act. But so what I'm saying is that we will be proactive around tax avoidance, around compliance and enforcement. Of course we will. But what I'm indicating in the letter as well is a matter for us to consider jointly around if you take the position of the UK government, of course it's a totally different budget process. They announce the budget and then there's all the scrutiny. We have a draft budget and scrutinise it and then vote on it. What I think we have to be considering is in a future process that as well as all the enforcement I've just spoken about, as well as the expectation of compliance, the culture that we create, I think we have to have a mechanism where the government can securely and safely be able to outline a tax position and address bad tax behaviour where people avoid it because they knew what we were going to do. And I just want that ability to be considered as to how we do that. As I say, going from a parliament that scrutinises how we spend money to a parliament that generates money through tax decision and spends money. And I just think we have some thinking jointly to do around how we protect the position of taxation in Scotland in a way that doesn't encourage bad behaviour.
So you're describing a situation where the Chancellor south of the border can sometimes surprise people with taxes. You feel you're flagging up tax changes in advance. Do you want to, the power to be able to surprise people with tax changes?
I'm not far too cynical, Mr. Johnson, on what my intentions are. But I'm sure we could all agree if we want to be able to generate tax that we have a degree of flexibility to do that with proper transparency and accountability. I mean, it's already the case, as the member knows, that we go to the chamber with redacted papers on what we may happen to set as, you know, as a tax rate. All I'm indicating is we might want to look at the overall process going forward, not necessarily in this transition year, I accept it's too tight for that, but as part of our joint work, we should look at our model isn't perfect and what would we adapt, and we should be clear that we shouldn't create a system that encourages, you know, bad tax behaviours that means that people escape what they should be paying, and I think we should take that issue very seriously. It's not about surprises, it's about prudent management of the public finances and a degree of equity and fairness for all.
Thank you. Can I raise two points with you, Cabinet Secretary, that I would certainly like a response to? The first is, in the fiscal framework, it does seem to me that paragraph 88 of the fiscal framework is more required than ever. This is the paragraph that says the UK and Scottish governments have agreed that appropriate and reciprocal information sharing arrangements will be put in place by both governments as well as by the OBR and the Scottish Fiscal Commission to undertake their respective responsibilities. Given the circumstances we're in, are they in place, and if not, how quickly can they be in place?
I defer to Alistair Brown, who can give you a more technical answer. My understanding is some of the detail, of course, is still under discussion because we're working some of these issues through.
Yes. The agreement in principle is, as you've read out, convener, from the the fiscal framework agreement, so that there is agreement that there will be information sharing arrangements. We're working on the detail of that with HMRC and Department for Work and Pensions. And in addition, the Scottish Fiscal Commission is discussing with the Office for Budget Responsibility what information that the tax forecasters need to share.
Given the circumstances we are in, this would be something perhaps which a degree of urgency would now apply to? It's certainly on our side, and let's hope on theirs too.
We're certainly taking these discussions forward as quickly as we can. And there's a system of governance, as we call it, in place, so that if for any reason we don't make the progress that we expect to, we can refer the matter up.
I just use those words again, a degree of urgency, yeah. I think, is required on that. The second point I'd just like to put to you, Cabinet Secretary, is this. I've been very struck in... You have been reading up into your position too, and so have I. I've been very struck by the principles that FEAG set at the outset of devolution as to why we have the arrangement that we have. And if I can bore you for 2 seconds with the what they are, the FEAG principles are these. Firstly, to provide opportunities for the Parliament to comment on expenditure priorities and to influence the Executive's preparation of budgets. To provide the opportunity for the public to have an opportunity to put their views to subject committees, as well as individual MSPs at an early stage in the process. To provide sufficient time for the Parliament to consider and debate proposals fully. To provide a balance between the requirements for parliamentary scrutiny and the needs of the executive, to provide some degree of certainty so that ongoing activities can continue without prolonged uncertainty, to provide an efficient mechanism to deliver financial motions to be debated by the Parliament, to provide a meaningful role for subject committees in the Finance Committee, to deliver timeous decisions on tax varying power and the budget, as well as the interim spending approval and budget amendments, to engage all MSPs, to facilitate the executive's formulation of proposals, and to provide for the right of amendment. Now, it seems to me that while we can debate how this happens, those are sound principles, and they're principles that underpin what this Parliament is about, and many of them have been expressed in one way or another in this meeting today. I am keen to know whether the Scottish Government still accepts those principles, and if you agree with me that they should underpin the work we're going to do in co-designing the process going forward, both this year and in future years?
Broadly, yes, as long as we all understand that those principles were created in a time when this was just a spending parliament. And absolutely, as they relate to that, yes. And that's a pretty good starting position to then embark on our joint work. So I'm not, you know, abandoning those principles. I'm just saying we have to adapt in light of the fact that our tax powers and our maturity as a parliament has changed, and our ability to be adept to circumstances will also have to be taken into account. So, yeah, I think it's a good starting position.
I very much think, as our clerks enter in discussion with you, those are the things that certainly I hope will underpin how we take this forward. I think there are things that have been expressed by the committee today as things that are of importance to them. Can I thank you very much for that? That has been a lengthy but I think very informative session. We are now going to move on immediately to item 2 in the agenda, which is the temporary appointment to the Scottish Fiscal Commission. We have a copy of your letter regarding the resignation of Andrew Hughes-Hallett from the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And on behalf of the committee, and can I say personally, as somebody who's known Andy Hughes-Hallett for a long time, I want to put on record our appreciation for the work and significant contribution he's made to the work of the Commission and to Scotland in general, and to pass on our best wishes to him. Cabinet Secretary, you've written to us about this matter. The letter has been circulated, as I understand it. We'd like you to, if you'd like to make some opening comments, but it appears a clear matter. And I think certainly the view you've expressed to us that the committee could and should meet your nominee early in September, but accepting the need to get somebody into post now would seem to be reasonable. But would you like to say a word or two about it?
No, thank you, Convener. Can I concur with your words and Andrew Hughes-Hallett? I am grateful for this opportunity to give evidence to the committee on the interim appointment to the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And I'd like to record my thanks to the committee for its understanding and willingness to consider this issue at such short notice. I wrote to the committee last week to inform you that Andrew Hallett has tendered his resignation from the Scottish Fiscal Commission. I'm very grateful to Professor Hallett for his service to the Commission and the valuable contribution he has made to the Commission's work over the last 2 years. My immediate priority was and is to ensure that the Commission has sufficient capacity to discharge its functions in relation to the 2017-18 Scottish Budget. Having discussed this issue with Lady Susan Rice, Chair of the Commission, I decided to make an interim appointment to the Non-Statutory Commission at the earliest opportunity. I wrote again to the committee yesterday to notify you of my decision to appoint Professor Charles Nolan of the University of Glasgow to serve as a member of the Non-Statutory Commission up to the 30th of March 2017. Professor Nolan will bring a wealth of relevant economic experience to the Commission, having held posts at the Bank of England and several academic institutions, and intend to commence the process of appointing two members to the Commission with effect from 1st of April 2017, when it is due to be established as a non-ministerial department and office holder in the Scottish Administration. In accordance with the Scottish Fiscal Commission Act, this process will be regulated by the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life, and while I will make appointments, they'll be subject to approval by the Scottish Parliament. I look forward to answering any questions that the committee may have.
Excellent. I'll take comments. I would declare an interest as somebody who is, even in a minor capacity, employed by the University of Glasgow. Other comments? If there are no comments, the committee approves that, and we will look forward to meeting Professor Nolan on in the summer, after the summer. Is that acceptable? Right, in those circumstances, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. It's good of you to come. Thanks to your officials. I'm sure we will see you again before too long. I'm going to move this meeting into private session, and then I think we will take a brief comfort break, time for a cup of coffee, presumably. We'll start again within 2 or 3 minutes if we can. Thank you.